welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, the percentage of people in the U.S. born in another country is rising. John Russell and I have that report. Then Jill Robbins presents this week's education report. Finally, we hear the lesson of the day from Jill Robbins and Andrew Smith. But first.
Last year, the percentage of U.S. residents who were foreign-born grew to its highest level in more than 100 years. Recently, the U.S. Census Bureau released its yearly American Community Survey that provided detailed numbers. The American Community Survey follows family life, income, education levels, disabilities, military service, and employment, among other subjects.
The study, or survey, shows the share of people born outside the United States increased in 2023 to 14.3% from 13.9% in 2022. International migrants have become a main cause of population growth in recent years. Migrants are increasing their share of the population as Americans are having fewer children compared with years past. The percentage of the foreign-born population in the United States has not been this high since 1910, when it was 14.7%. At that time, waves of people came to the U.S., in search of a better life. Luciana Bracco moved legally to Miami from Venezuela. We knew that here you can have savings, live well. Here you can have normal services such as water and electricity, she said. Bracco's move was part of a special official program known as a humanitarian parole program. She came with her boyfriend, parents, and brother in April 2023. I like Miami and the opportunities that I have had, she said. In 2023, international migrants accounted for more than two-thirds of the population growth in the United States. In the 2020s, they have made up almost three-fourths of U.S. growth. The growth appears to be mainly people coming from Latin America. Their estimated share of the foreign-born population increased to 51.2% from 50.3% in 2022. Latin Americans have increased among U.S. residents born in another country. The share of foreign-born residents from Europe and Asia has dropped a little.
Nicole Diaz was an opposition activist in Venezuela. She said she left after her life was threatened. Diaz lived in Peru and Ecuador before moving to the Miami area legally in February 2023 with her husband and 9-year-old daughter. Diaz described herself as 100% happy living in South Florida, where the family pays $2,300 a month for a two-bedroom apartment. After being in different countries, working here is relaxed, despite the language, Diaz said. But housing is very expensive, and we have been evaluating moving to another state because here all the salary goes for the rent. Delaware was among the states with the largest increases in the foreign-born population from 2022 to 2023. The small state went to 11.2% from 9.9%. Georgia went to 11.6% from 10.7%. And New Mexico went from 10.2% from 9.3%. The share of the foreign-born population dropped slightly in Washington, D.C., Idaho, Iowa, Maine, Minnesota, Montana, North Dakota, and Oregon. The Census Bureau numbers do not show whether people are in the United States legally or illegally. Illegal immigration has become a top political issue in 2024. The study says the percentage of U.S. residents who say they are Hispanic, no matter what race, increased last year to 19.4% from 19.1% the year before. At the same time, those who say they are non-Hispanic white dropped from 57.7% to 57.1%. The share of U.S. residents who identify as black dropped a little from 12.2% to 12.1%. And the share of U.S. residents who identify as Asian went from 5.9% to 6%. The average age of U.S. residents continues to increase. The median age went from 39 in 2022 to 39.2 in 2023. Americans born after World War II, from the 1940s to the mid-1960s, are known as the Baby Boom Generation. They are now senior citizens. The generation known as Millennials, those born between the early 1980s and middle 1990s, are entering middle age. While the share of children under age 18 remained the same at 21.7%, the share of senior citizens aged 65 and over increased to 17.7% from 17.3%. Other numbers show that working from home is decreasing after the COVID-19 pandemic. The share of employees working from home dropped last year to 13.8% from 15.2% in 2022. The survey also showed that the median cost of renting, plus utilities and related costs, grew faster than median home values in 2023 for the first time in 10 years. The 3.8% rise in rental costs was the largest yearly increase since at least 2011. However, the share of renter income spent on rent and utility costs remained unchanged at 31% in 2023. That finding suggests that incomes kept up with rent increases, the Census Bureau said. I'm John Russell.
And I'm Ashley Thompson.
This autumn, students in the Finnish town of Riihimäki headed back to school with backpacks full of books. This marks a change from recent years. For the past 10 years, the Finnish government pushed laptops and other electronic devices in the classroom. Finland's public education system is known for its good results, and its readiness to try new teaching methods. Until recently, many schools gave laptops for free to all students from as early as age 11. But Finnish parents and teachers have become increasingly concerned over the effect of screens on children. Riihimäki is a town of about 30,000 people. It sits 70 kilometers north of the capital, Helsinki. In 2018, the town's middle schools stopped using most books. But this school year, schools in Riihimäki are going back to pen and paper. Young people are using phones and digital devices so much these days that we don't want school to be one of the places where children are only staring at screens, said Maya Kaunanen, an English teacher at Pohjolan Rene Middle School. The distractions that come with the use of digital devices make many children restless and unable to give their full attention to learning, Kaunanen said. She added, "Most students just did the exercises as quick as they could, so they could then move on to using social media. And it took them no time at all to change tabs in the browser. So when the teacher came round to them, they could say, 'Yes, I was doing this exercise.'" Across Finland, children's learning results have been slowly getting worse in recent years. In answer, the government plans new laws to ban the use of personal devices such as phones during school hours to cut back on screen time. One of Kaunanen's students is 14-year-old Ele Soka. She said she did not always pay attention to the school subjects when learning digitally. Instead, she moved to another web page. Eighth graders Mikko Mantila and Inka Vara, both 14, said their concentration has improved since books returned to the classrooms. "Reading for one is much easier, and I can read much faster from books," Mantila said. "And if you have to do homework late at night, it's easier to go to sleep when you haven't just been looking at a device," Vara added. Mina Peltopuro is a psychologist working with the town on the change. She said the total screen time should be cut because Finnish teenagers currently stare at a screen for up to 6 hours each day on average. She added that too much use of electronic devices comes with both physical and mental risks, such as eye problems and growing anxiety. Peltopuro added that the brain is at risk when trying to do more than one thing at a time. "Especially at a young age, one cannot manage it well," she said. I'm Jill Robbins.
Jill Robbins is here now to talk more about that education report. Hi, Jill. Thanks for joining me.
Hi, Ashley. Thanks for having me on the show.
This week, your report centered on Finland's push to move back towards actual books instead of tablets, laptops, and other digital devices in the classroom. Finland has long seen very good results in its education system. But can you tell us a little more about the reason for this change taking place?
Sure, Ashley. One of the problems parents and teachers both find is that students are so easily distracted when they use digital devices like laptops in class.
That was one word I heard in the report, distracted. Can you explain for our listeners the other forms of this word?
Distract is the verb, and it means to take one's attention away from something. The noun form distraction is the thing that takes your attention away.
For example, social media is a major distraction.
You've got that right.
And you used another word that connects to this idea, concentration.
That comes from the verb to concentrate, which is what we do when we focus on something or pay close attention to it. It was interesting that the students said they noticed they could concentrate better when reading books.
Yes, one teacher said in the report that students were able to switch quickly between tabs on their digital devices to look at other materials, and that keeps them from focusing or concentrating.
Exactly. Students also noticed that reading on screens affected their sleep. That might be because of the blue light from the screen.
That is another interesting point. And of course, we all know that sleep affects our ability to learn and remember things. Well, thanks again, Jill, for talking with me today. And thanks so much for that report.
My pleasure, Ashley.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
On tomorrow's education report, some police departments in the U.S. are experimenting with AI tools to help them produce incident reports. Police officers who have tried the AI chatbots praise the technology as a time saver. Yet some government lawyers, legal experts, and others have expressed concerns about the AI-produced reports. John Russell will bring us that story tomorrow. You can read and listen to his report on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Mateo.
And my name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Let's jump right in with a short clip from Lesson 20 of the series. We'll play the clip three times in a row. Listen to Anna ask a question and then make a statement. And listen for how she pronounces the small word, can.
Can you teach? You can be a teacher in a school. Can you teach? You can be a teacher in a school. Can you teach? You can be a teacher in a school.
There's a difference between how she pronounces the word can when she asks the question, can you teach? And how she pronounces it when she makes a statement. Listen one more time.
Can you teach? You can be a teacher in a school.
With her statement, you can be a teacher in a school, she says the word can a bit faster. And the vowel sound changes from a, like in apple, to the schwa, a. This change of vowel sound is something that happens when we talk faster.
That's a funny word, schwa, isn't it? When English speakers do not put any stress on a vowel, it sounds like this. We write it with the upside down E.
Why do you think we have a special word for this sound, Jill?
I think we need a special word for it because it can be written using A, E, I, O, U, or Y in words. It is the most common vowel sound in English because it represents unstressed vowels. Lesson 20 of Let's Learn English has a pronunciation practice video that explains this change of vowel sound. Let's listen. In slow speech, can sounds like can. In fast speech, it often sounds like can. Listen to Anna talking to Pete about being a teacher.
Can you teach? You can be a teacher in a school.
But now, let's listen to the negative forms of the verb can. These, of course, are the words cannot and can't.
Well, it might seem simple. We want you to know how and when native speakers use each form. When we want people to clearly understand that we are unable to do something, we sometimes use the longer form cannot.
For example, when you talk on the phone and you have to explain a problem, you want to be sure that the other person understands you. So you might choose to use the form cannot. For example, if you are locked out of a room or locked out of a building, you might say, I've tried the key over and over and I cannot open the door.
Yeah, cannot gives emphasis to the meaning. As we explained in a previous lesson of the day, emphasis is spelled E-M-P-H-A-S-I-S. It means extra importance and is similar to the word stress.
Another reason we might choose to say cannot when speaking on the phone is because there is only a small difference in pronunciation between the positive form can and the negative form, can't. Sometimes you can hear the letter T when we say can't, but other times it is harder to hear, and it just sounds like this, can't. In American English, we call that a held T. Instead of pronouncing the T, your tongue just comes to a stop against the hard part of the roof of your mouth just behind the upper front teeth.
Maybe we'd better say that location one more time.
Good idea. I'll repeat that. The tongue comes to a stop against the hard part of the roof of your mouth just behind the upper front teeth. In the pronunciation video of Lesson 20, you can hear Pete first pronounce can't with the letter T. And then the next time, you hear him pronounce it with the held T, can't. Let's listen.
No, I can't code. I can't teach. I can't cook. Anna, I can't do anything.
I noticed that when people send text messages, they often send a message saying I can, when I'm sure they mean I can't. I think that's because they're using their voice to write, or dictating, you know. The text and the phone software cannot tell the difference between the two words. How can we help our listeners hear and say the forms correctly?
Listen to these examples. I can, I can't. I can, I can't. When we say the positive form, we pronounce the letter N longer. The N sound, N, 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 lasts longer than in the negative form. In fact, in the negative form, because the tongue and voice stop, there is almost no sound of the letter N. Can't. So again, listen to the difference. I can, I can't. I can, I can't.
There is a difference, but it is small. If you cannot hear the difference, don't worry. Usually, you will know that it's the negative form just from the situation, from all the other information you get from the conversation.
And if you are speaking and want to be very clear, simply pronounce the letter T, like can't.
I'm Jill Robbins, and you're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. Andrew, earlier in the lesson, you said you were going to give the listeners more examples.
That's right. We're going to give examples of how we pronounce the verb can when we speak quickly. Jill, you can just ask me a question, and I'll answer it.
That sounds pretty easy. Are you ready?
Ready.
Can you do it?
Yeah, I can do it.
Can you see it?
Yeah, I can see it.
Can you come over?
Yeah, I can come over.
Can you send it to me?
Yeah, I can send it to you.
Can you hear a difference?
Yeah, I can hear a difference.
Can you smell it?
I can smell it.
Can you put it in the oven?
I can put it in the oven.
Can you open the door?
I can open the door.
Can you give me a hand?
I can give you a hand.
Can you give me a minute?
I can give you a minute.
Can you give me all your money?
I don't think so. I cannot give you all of my money.
Just checking to see if you were really listening. What can you give me?
Good question. I can give you, let's see, I can give you free advice.
Advice? You mean you can give me suggestions for how to fix a problem?
Sure.
Well, I don't have any problems.
You don't have any problems?
Not today.
Well, lucky you. I think maybe you should give me advice. So, how about this? I can thank you for helping me and our listeners with the Learning English Podcast.
It's the high point of my day. But I can't believe we spent the whole lesson talking about this one little word.
I can. Getting all the details of American pronunciation takes time, and people need lots of examples.
And there's much more our listeners can learn from Lesson 20 of Let's Learn English. In our next lesson of the day, we'll talk about an important topic from Lesson 20, having skills and knowing how to use them.
That is a great topic. I look forward to speaking with you about it. Until then, thanks for listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.